Yeah, thank you. It's a pleasure to have the opportunity to talk to you today. I was asked to present a case study showing how Adidas uses its history at the moment. I have to say I'm working for a department called History Management. We don't call ourselves archive because we always have to translate what we do to the marketing language of our colleagues. And so we say we are managing Adidas history that includes the corporate archive, the brand collection, and all questions related to our history. Few words about Adidas. Adidas is a global player in sports goods industry. So the company is named after its founder, Adolf, short Adi Dassler, and was founded in 1949. There was another company, Adi Dassler had together with his brother Rudolf, Rudi Dassler. You might have heard of the story. They both split up after the Second World War. And Rudolf founded Puma and Adi Dassler founded Adidas, and both companies are still located in the nice, small Franconian village Herzogenaurach. So, today Adidas has over 60,000 employees worldwide. As I said, we are a global player. And I think Ben mentioned that beforehand, in the sports goods industry, we are producing sport shoes, sport items, and so on. And we are not only selling the product, we are selling a kind of lifestyle and a mindset. And Adidas, as a company, has the strong belief that sport has the power to change lives. And now I quote my colleagues from brand communication. So everything we do is rooted back in sports. That's a quote taken from our corporate website. So that means the brand image has a strong link to our roots and heritage. And roots were also important for our founder, Adolf Dassler. He started collecting worn shoes to learn from them, to keep ideas, and also to enable his employees to have a look and to be inspired by them. So there was a brand collection from the beginning. And then the collection grew, and in 1974, a little museum was opened. And Adi Dassler himself, you see him on the image there, that's the elder man with the glasses, loved to show around athletes and to talk about the history of his company. The museum was closed in the mid of the 1990s as office space was needed. It's a pity. And the collection got kind of forgotten. And in 1998, it was this man, Karl-Heinz Lang, who was asked to build a global training center. And he was employed by Adi Dassler himself in the 70s, and he remembered his old boss to say, go to the archives, go to the attic, have a look at the old products and learn from them. And he said, this is something we definitely need for our young employees. So he took the collection, brought it to the Global Training Center and opened his little, he called it museum. In 2008, he approached the board and said, guys, we have to professionalize the collection because the collection was kind of hidden in this global training center and not really accessible and not really used. And thanks to the board, in 2008-2009, History Management was founded and the collection was professionalized. So today, we have a professional archive with archive conditions, climate and temperature control. We have a professional archive database. We try to digitize as much as possible. For the product, that means that we take professional images from 6 different angles, for apparels only 4, doesn't make sense otherwise, to make especially the visual content accessible to our employees. But I come to that back to that later. So our key goal is on the one hand, to keep our heritage, on the other hand, is to make it accessible for the benefit of the brand. So the collection itself consists of 25,000 historical products, 25,000 documents, and around about 20,000 images and videos. There you can see an image of our archive. But how do we use that collection, that big treasure? So we say, for us as an archive, it's really important to connect past, present, and future. And not only to recreate old products, It's more to be inspired by them, to reinterpret them, to put them in a new context. And the shoes you see there is a perfect example how our designers work with our archive content. The three first shoes, that's the Micropacer from 1984, we have the Boston Super and the Fire. These three shoes inspired a totally new model, the so-called NMD. And this is a new icon, top seller, and totally archive inspired. So from our experience from the last 8 years, the archive has three main tasks. One is, of course, inform, to give pure information, the right information, as some people mentioned beforehand, everything has to be bulletproof, but also to inspire product, to inspire marketing campaigns, and to engage. So of course, we answer requests, internal and external requests, but most of the requests we get are internal ones. So colleagues are reaching out and asking questions about products, about facts, fact check, but many of them just want to come to the archive and really work with the actual item. The example you see there, these are some footwear designers having a look at the shoe called LA Trainer to do a reissue. And in the picture on the right hand, you can see the old shoe from the archive and the reissue. So we also have design visits. And in this case, we act as consultants. So colleagues are coming with a rough idea. Maybe it's, oh, let's do something with the early 90s. What do we have in the archive? And then we really talk to them. We are a partner, a reliable partner, and talk what they have in mind, what could be done, what we would like to offer them to see. But it's not only internal people coming to the archive. It's also external designers who love to be there to get their inspiration. And to be honest, we were really surprised that people love to see the archive itself, because it's, for us, it's a working room and it looks really dry, but people love the special atmosphere. And in the last years, we had many, many questions to do shootings in the archive for films, for example, to prove authenticity. And you can see there an external brand ambassador, Pharrell Williams. He's been to the archive 2 times, and he did a collection for Adidas inspired by archive items. We also have a brand exhibition that's an internal exhibition showcasing the DNA of the brand. There was another exhibition, more sports history focused, but when we came in place in 2009, we said we have to change that because we as a company need a place where we could display what's our DNA, what's our impact on sports history, but also cultural history. And this exhibition is changed on a frequent basis, 2 times a year. And in the middle, you can see our PR manager, Oliver Brücken, and he loves to use this place really for meeting brand ambassadors and shooting images. We guide athletes there. We have young athletes where we really want to sign a contract. And then when their managers want to negotiate, they show what rich history Adidas has. And so they've been guided around and say, okay, you can be part of this history. And often athletes hand over signed products also in the exhibition. We have a last showcase, which is empty. And then we can say, okay, now this is your moment. Now you are part of our history. And this is always quite emotional. But as I mentioned, we are a global player. We are not only based in Herzogenaurach. We have also some headquarters in America, Shanghai, and so on. And we can't invite our colleagues or all of our colleagues to see the archive. So the archive had to go digital. At first, we did an external website. It's the adidasarchive.org. And there, a small selection of our items is shown. We have digital, we call them exhibitions. And users also have the possibility to create their own exhibition. We have little films. And this page grants access to a small selection of our archive. We have digitized catalogs there as well, what the community of collectors outside really love. It's compared to Mercedes-Benz, they are really unorganized. There's a huge community of especially footwear collectors, but they are also ball collectors. And they love to have a resource to do research. And our catalogs, especially, and the footwear things there, is a great resource for them, as well as being a resource for professional museums, like the Smithsonian, for example. Internally, we have an, we call it database as well. It's called Archive Search. It's hosted on the intranet, so employees have access 24/7 to our collection, can research it, and there they, of course, get a huge, a wide selection of what's in the archive. So we are still in the middle of cataloging things. We started 2009, as I mentioned, and there are still some unopened boxes, so we find treasures on a daily basis. And we try to add as much information as possible and uploaded it there. So the information for our colleagues is downloadable. They can use the images internally, they can browse the catalogs. Our designers love that. It's really cool to prepare a creative direction or to work on an actual object. So engage. Engage is the third pillar of what an archive can do. As I mentioned, the archive room itself is, offers a great spirit. But not only the room, it's also the object. So every object tells a story, as has been mentioned beforehand. And digitization is good, but you need the physical object to really tell a story. So we do different loans. I called it History on Tour. We lend some objects to the MoMA, for example. There is a great sneaker exhibition in the USA at the moment. It's Rise of Sneaker Culture, which is traveling to Australia. We lend shoes to the Victoria and Albert Museum, to the Centre Pompidou, for example. Really to show that Adidas also has an impact, a cultural impact, and also on design history. But we also lend objects to our colleagues, which are present at sneaker fairs, comparable to what Mercedes-Benz is doing. That's the right example. And we have athletes also in the archive. That's Derrick Rose, an American basketball player. And he went to the archive and I showed to him some early basketball boots. And it was a really nice experience for him because we had all the old basketball boots in one row and the last shoe was his latest model. I said, okay, you see where it's coming from and now you're also part of a history. And he was really proud. We sometimes also have brand influencers in the archive. This is an example of some female women's influencers. And they are pretty impressed because she's a blogger also from the US. Only US examples in here, sorry. And she loves really the idea of storytelling. So she's been to the archive and we were talking about how products can tell a story about people who wore them, design history and so on. And we do that quite often, and that and they spread the word and the picture of the archive in the end. But we also engage employees, and this is a strong element some companies really forget. So employees need to be to identify with their company, and at Adidas, the average age of an employee is 32. So quite young, and the employee turnover is also quite fast. So you have young employees not really connected to history most of the time, and to connect them to a company with such a long history and such an impact on sports history, it's really important so that they know where the company comes from, what the values are, what the mindset is. And they love it. So in the end, it's all about authenticity. So what we as an archive can do, we can endorse the brand, an authentic brand image. So we deliver facts that make sure that people outside know this brand is authentic and proves that in the end. There's another project what ensures this authenticity. It's funny enough, I was talking about products all the time, as you might have noticed. Until 2014, Adidas had no global archive, so there were no documents in the Adidas archive. And in the end of 2014, we started a project to research our company's history. We chose an independent partner, the German Gesellschaft für Unternehmensgeschichte, and they supported us with independent historians to really research our company's history, because showing products is the one side, but delivering facts is the other. And as a nice side project, we start building a corporate archive right now. So, this is what we quite often talk or tell our colleagues. History can make a difference for a company. So first of all, as simple as it sounds, it supports the efficiency in our daily work. When we started, we had a case that people came and reinvented the same thing every 4 years for the Olympics, for example. They weren't aware that colleagues did the same 4 or 8 or even 15 years ago. History inspires products and campaigns. It engages consumers and fans, as well as, I said, employees. It creates brand loyalty, and it delivers powerful stories. And it helps to endorse an authentic brand image. So I'm in at the end. If there are any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
Thank you. Questions for Susan? One over there.
Susan, you're the first person that's talked about exhibitions. And can you talk a little bit about your exhibition development process, how that works, who the people are that you work with?
So usually we get all the exhibition makers reach out to us and say, well, we have an idea of an exhibition X, Y, Z. And then we, of course, talk to external communication department. We have to align that. And And if we think this exhibition adds a value to our brand, because we are not creating the exhibition, we are only delivering objects and information. And if we think that it adds value, then we work also as consultant, because sometimes we can't give away the products they're asking for. So sometimes the products are too fragile, or they are so valuable that we can't give them away. Then we have to look for something else, but we always find a good solution. Then we set up a loan contract, that's also no problem, and then it's just the normal way things go. Does it answer the question? Thank you.
Question back here.
Hi, Susan. Thank you very much for that presentation. It was really interesting. I was just wondering, like every presentation this morning, I think it's become very clear how important the history is to the brand. But I just wondered if you felt internally that the business then recognizes how important it is that the records they're creating now are actually the future archive. Without sounding too cliche, I just wondered if they recognize then the importance of the current records in the same way.
Good question. As I said, we are in the process, and it's that also making them aware or creating that awareness is a constant process. You always have to talk, you always have to deliver presentations, facts, and so on. There are some departments which are pretty aware and pretty happy to have us. All the designers love the archive. Our legal department is pretty happy. Sometimes it's harder to get it one level above.
Another question? If not, thank you so much, Susan, for coming here. Thank you.
Thank you.